Howdy, folks. My name is Jim Nash. I'm your Oakland County Water Resources Commissioner. Welcome to our new show called Water by the Quarter. We're trying to, in this show, inform the public, educate them about what our water systems are, what they do, how often we have to work on them, and all the things surrounding them. So today, I'm going to be talking about our Oakland County combined sewer systems. We have a significant number of our population living on these combined systems, the George W. Kuhn retention basin, known as the 12 Towns Drain, in Madison Heights, Michigan, is one of our most important. Today, my guest is from my own office, Oakland County Water Resources Commission's office, is Chief Engineer Gary Nigro. Gary is in charge of all our retention treatment basins, which are the basins that we use for our combined systems. He's one of the most intelligent people I know. I will tell you this, that my office has some amazing folks working for it. We have great engineers, and Gary is one of those engineers. I'm just proud of my whole staff here, but Gary is really a standout. Not only does he do this work for us, but on his off time, he built himself a house. So this is one of those things that my folks are multi-talented people. So today's Gary is going to be talking about these systems. Gary, why don't we start out with what is the George W. Kuhn Basin?
Thanks, Jim. So the GWK, we always use all these acronyms, right? So GWK stands for the George W. Kuhn Retention Treatment Basin. And George W. Kuhn himself was a former drain commissioner for Oakland County for many years. I think 28 years. So
that's right.
Yeah. And what the basin does, it's probably better to start off and say, like, what exactly is a retention treatment basin?
Right? Sure.
So a retention treatment basin, what it does is it collects combined sewage from overflowing into the lakes and rivers and streams, and it holds it, retains it for during a particular rain event, and then once the rain event subsides, the basin drains back out or is pumped out back into the sanitary collection system for full treatment at a wastewater treatment plant. In our case, it's Detroit's wastewater treatment plant.
So the system is a very large system. When it was built, it was the biggest in the country, at least, right? So why don't you describe what the actual facility is and what it, where it is and what it looks like?
Sure, I can do that. So the GWK basin is located near 12 Mile and I-75 in Madison Heights, and it runs underground for approximately 2 miles all the way up to 13 Mile and DeQuinder in that area. It's approximately 124 million gallons of combined sewage storage, it was built through multiple stages. Really, the most recent project was completed in around 2005-2006, but maybe this would be a good time to explain what some of the history of the whole entire area. So Southeast Oakland County is mostly a combined sewer system, meaning that the same pipes that carry your sanitary sewage also carry storm drainage. Back in the day, when every time that you had a major rain event, that combined sewage would end up going into lakes and rivers and streams completely untreated. Since about the 1940s on, there's a series of sanitary interceptors that would intercept the dry weather flow, which would mean, so these are huge pipe underground, right? And on a dry day, there's very little, maybe a couple inches of sanitary sewage flowing in them, and that sewage is intercepted by the sanitary interceptors and taken all the way, flows all the way down to Detroit's wastewater treatment plant for treatment. But in a wet weather condition, when it rains, then the Detroit's wastewater treatment plant can't actually handle all that additional flow of the combined storm flow and sanitary sewage together. So what would happen is it would just discharge through these CSOs, a combined sewer overflow point, straight into the lakes and rivers and streams. So back in when the system was really built out and through the 1920s to 40s to 50s, so in Southeast Michigan, it rains about 55 times a year on average. So about 55 times a year, you'd have all this combined sewage just flowing straight into the lakes and rivers and streams. So, what what the Oakland County, back then, Drain Commissioner's Office, what it was called, did is they created a large collection system beneath those southeast Oakland County, which, and then put a weir, which is basically like a dam, in the system at the outfall point. So what that weir does is it impounds that water. So that water, you end up collecting, impounding about 30 million gallons of combined sewage. So what that did is that cut the frequency of the discharges in Oakland County from about 55 times a year, because that's how many times it rains, down to about 25. So it cut it approximately in half, all right? It stayed that way. That was built in the early 60s, that first outfall structure that created the weir and impounded that's combined sewage. So we want to do better than that, 25 times a year. It was still untreated at that point. If we had if the rain event was large enough, it would still overtop the weir and go straight out into the lakes and rivers and streams. So in the early 1970s is when we enclosed a huge portion of the Red Run Drain. And what that did is that was creating the actual basin today, the majority of the retention treatment basin. I'll keep using those acronyms, RTB. If you hear me say RTB later, I mean retention treatment basin. So in the early 1970s is when the basin itself was built. And at that point, it added a disinfection system and an additional 60 million gallons of storage for a total of about 90 million gallons. And what that did is that made it, it took us from about 25 discharges a year down to about 12 to 15 in that range. So pretty much cut it in half again. And then at that point also, the frequency of these discharges to the environment was a lot lower. But what it also did is it added sodium hypochlorite, which is just a fancy word for bleach, added sodium hypochlorite disinfection system. So if the basin was starting to fill up with this combined sewage during a rain event, it was actually being injected with sodium hypochlorite and thereby killing all the fecal bacteria in that flow. So if it did happen to spill over the final effluent weir at the basin, it would end up... it was disinfected and safe for the environment at that point.
So the water at that point is pretty much even cleaner than the water that it's receiving. I mean, the natural water is no worse than what we have. I mean, it's no better than what we're introducing this to.
Sure. You're talking about like the normal storm runoff.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
If you think about it, storm runoff isn't necessarily clean.
No, that's right.
There's a lot of pollutants and sediment and debris that is carried through the, you know, rain event that make its way into the lakes and rivers and streams. So at this point, our basin is actually disinfecting the flow and with some settling. So that was from the 1970s on. And it stayed that way for till around 1999, 2001 is when we developed plans to actually improve the basin even further. So what we did is we chose a section right near I-75. To widen the basin, and which added another 30 million gallons of system, 30 million gallons of storage in the system. What it also did is we added fine screens at that point. So any floatables that were going through that system would be screened out of the flow before it would enter a lake in the event of a discharge, additional weirs, baffle walls, and also making that section very wide and deep. It slows the flow down so much through that area that a lot of the solids end up settling out in that area, which are then disposed of later. And the increase in that actual the volume, as I just mentioned, another 30 million gallons, got us up to, I think the total today is about 124 million gallons of storage at the GWK retention treatment basin. And with the addition of that additional volume, it reduced the frequency of discharges from about 15 a year down to about 8. So on average now, it's only about 8 times a year that facility actually discharges to the environment. So,
and it's treated to the point where it's as good a water as the environment is receiving.
Disinfected, screened, settled. Yeah, exactly. So we have a very good track record for that. So
we do. We've gotten awards for it. So beyond that, I want it really quick. You mentioned how long. It's about a mile and a half or 2 miles long.
It's a little over 2 miles.
What's on top of that? People don't realize it's there.
No, no one's the wiser unless you were born during the construction back in the 70s or lived in those areas during that time. It's actually, I think, 2.1 miles underground. It stretches, like I mentioned, I think from Stevenson Highway and 75 area right at 12 mile all the way up to just north of 13 mile on DeQuinder. And on top of it are mostly parks. There's a youth soccer fields on top of the basin. There is a golf course. There is the water park, the Red Oaks Water Park, and also the Red Oaks Dog Park is down near the end. So there's four different parks built on top of the basin. So,
okay, why don't you put on the one for the GWK basin? This is the picture of the basin, an aerial view. This is the large one. The part with has the long building there is where the screens are.
That's right. The screening facility is about 300 feet wide. So that long narrow building there contains all of the fine screens that screen all that any floatables. And think this is combined flow. This is storm drain and combined with sanitary sewage. So anything that washes down the storm drains makes its way
cigarette
through
butts,
this system.
Garbage,
everything.
All kinds of things.
Pop cans, napkins, everything. Exactly.
Which in a separated system, all that would just be flushed into the water. So all this would be polluting in our lakes, rivers, and streams. So this helps that. It significant amount of water is then put back into there without any kind of garbage in it.
That's correct. Yes. Yep. Having the screens in there pulls out things, even things like you wouldn't think about, like in the spring, there's have those little maple trees have the helicopters on them, the keys, tree
right.
keys, right?
Right.
Those leaves, everything that flows into the storm system ends up getting raked back out.
Yeah. That's right. So these are combined systems. What other combined systems do we have? This serves the bottom very corner of the county. What other retention treatment basins do we have that we operate?
There are actually three other retention treatment basins a little farther west in the county. We'll just name them. So one of them is the Acacia Park Retention Treatment Basin, and Acacia Park is the building itself that houses the equipment actually looks like a horse stable. It was meant to look like that, and it's placed. It's in the I believe it's called the Doug Evans Nature Preserve. So the community comes and uses this area and walks around it, and most of them are none the wiser for what that facility actually is. There's sort of a meadow there kind of behind the building that has earth cover over the top of the basin. That one, as I mentioned, I don't know if I mentioned this a minute ago or not, but the GWK is the largest retention treatment basin in the United States of America. So when I say 124 million gallons, it's to put it into perspective, this one right here that I'm talking about, Acacia Park, is 4 million gallons. And that serves the communities in that area around there. So, like I said, it's made to fit into this surrounding. It looks like a horse stable, right? Another one we have is the Birmingham Retention Treatment Basin. That one is actually right in Birmingham, and it's in Linden Park. And there's a little playground and stuff there, and there's a nature trail that walks by there. A lot of people in the Birmingham area use that, but that one is actually made to look like a grist mill. It's an old stone building, and it has a slate roof. Same thing, and that facility right there actually houses a lot of equipment, such as the disinfection system for those facilities, as well as all the pumps that dewater the basin after the rain event is over. And then the final one, and that one's about 5 million gallons, that one. So, and then the final of the smaller RTBs is called the Bloomfield Village Retention Treatment Facility. That one is actually located in right near Seaholm High School in the edge of Birmingham. It's actually in Bloomfield Township, I believe. But, maybe I misspoke there, because it's actually on the Birmingham Golf Course, a public golf course there. So, and because it was built under a golf course, this basin, that one is 10 million gallons, by the way. We made the building that houses the equipment look like a golf clubhouse. So, and there's been times where our staff is there working and during at least a sunny day, and people will come up asking where the bag drop is. So, and we actually built, when that was designed, we actually built some bathrooms into it. So it's right next to a fairway, and as the golfers come by, they can actually use the bathrooms that are built into that retention treatment basin. So,
well, there you go. Now, so these are the same functions and the same operation as the big GWK, but each one has a smaller area that feeds it, right? So even though it's the same thing, it's just a smaller area, and that's why they're smaller.
That's exactly right. Yeah, okay. Yeah. So it depends on the size of the actual collection system. You know, when I say that, I mean the neighborhoods and the cities and the villages that actually contribute to particular water courses, if you will, really. The combined collection system.
Right. So these communities that are served by all these, the GWK, all the water from there that is overflowed in a larger event, that all ends up in the Clinton River. So it's part of the Clinton River watershed.
That's correct.
The other three that you mentioned are in the Rouge River. So they're in the Rouge River watershed. So the water that comes out of them goes into the Rouge River.
That's correct, Jim.
Okay. Yep. So some of these communities are actually split between those two. Like Birmingham is split. They have about half their community goes to the GWK, and about half their community goes to these other two facilities that they operate.
That's true. Yeah. Certain communities. There's 14 communities in Southeast Oakland County that are tributary to the George W. Kuhn Basin, but some of those, the Birmingham is a good example, because Birmingham, part of the flow does go to the GWK, but part also goes to the Birmingham Basin, and I believe some goes to the Bloomfield Village Basin also. So there's actually, Birmingham kind of has three different districts that flow in different directions there. So,
right. Like Ferndale, all of Ferndale, all of Huntington Woods, all of Pleasant Ridge, all their stormwater goes through that facility and their sewage.
That's correct.
Clawson, so Troy, just a little bit of Troy, right?
Troy is mostly separated flow. There's a small portion of Troy near the southern part of Troy that does flow towards the basin, but a lot of it actually, most of the middle and the northern part of Troy is actually separated flow.
So their systems go directly into the lakes, rivers, and streams without treatment or anything. So that as all separated systems are.
Yeah, their storm drains do. And then their sanitary sewers run in separate pipe and go down to Detroit for treatment. So.
Okay. So some of the communities like Southfield, just a little bit of Southfield goes to the GWK, and the rest is separated, right? Because they don't flow into any of the other RTBs.
That's correct, right. Yeah. Southfield, just the... I guess it'd be the eastern edge of Southfield goes towards the GWK. And really, these district boundaries, I mean, if you were to look at a river watershed map, that's really where the boundary is. You know, like Southfield, the part of Southfield that flows towards the Rouge River is separate. The part of Southfield that flows towards the Clinton River and through the GWK system is combined.
Yeah. Right, so everything flows with gravity. So wherever the high point in the watersheds is, that's where they begin, and then they flow down into the actual rivers, and whatever flow is going into that is what's taken there. In a way, what these do is that these, you mentioned it briefly, but these give relief to the big sewer treatment plants, because they're used to taking sewer without all that extra water from stormwater. If they were trying to receive stormwater from a combined system, it would just overpower them and they couldn't treat all that. So part of what we're doing is protecting those facilities.
That's exactly right. So for instance, just because I know the numbers, so in the GBK system, our sanitary contractual capacity down to Detroit is 260 cubic feet per second of flow. So that's a big flow. If you think about a cubic foot of water moving per second, that's 260. It seems like a lot. But during a 10-year rain event, the frequency of a 10, maybe I should explain that. So
yeah, that's a good idea. People have heard that maybe, but they don't know what it means.
Yes, we use those terms a lot. Things like rainfall frequency. So a 10-year rain event would be a rain event that statistically should happen only once every 10 years. So it's a major rain event. A 10-year rain event makes the news. All right. So that's a major soaker. So these facilities, like the GWK, is designed to be able to adequately treat and pass the flow through the facility from a 10-year rain event. So I just mentioned 260 CFS is what Detroit can accept from us. A 10-year rain event for this drainage district generates closer to 7,000 CFS. So you can see where, Detroit's treatment plant wouldn't be able to handle an additional 7,000 cubic feet of flow during a major rain event. So as I mentioned, the history of it, you know, in the past, that flow, that additional, you know, 6,800 cubic feet per second would just flow straight into the lakes and rivers and streams completely untreated. But after we built the basin, now we capture that flow. We fill the basin up, we settle it, we store it, and then pump it back down to Detroit after the rain event is over.
Yep. Good. So these were cleaned up some years ago now. So we really don't have any kind of combined sewer that overflow without treatment in Oakland County.
That's correct. And it's funny because when I first started working at Oakland County, these things have been in place for so long. Say, like I mentioned, the GWK was in place since the basin itself since the early 70s with some in-system storage even before that. And then the other RTBs, the three smaller ones in the Rouge system, were built right around the mid-90s. So they're going on 25 years old now themselves. So every time, when I came into the county, I learned about retention treatment basins and CSO facilities, knowing that we had all these basins in place. So then I'd go to these conferences and seminars, you know, in other states, and they'd be talking about, our city has 75 CSOs, and I'm going, oh my gosh, 75 CSO facilities. Like, I can't even imagine that. But what they meant is not RTBs, not retention treatment basins, but untreated CSO outfalls. They might have 70, 80, 100 of these things in a large city, you know, like New York or something like that, where the system, when it becomes inundated with water, it ends up going straight into the rivers untreated. So ours has been around for quite a while and doing a good job for many years.
Yep. I want to also just real quick, we do a lot more maintenance on these facilities than some operations do. It's vitally important that when after every storm, we have a system in there to flush out the whole facility so we don't build up, you know, things on the floor which end up almost turning into concrete themselves. And if you don't do these kind of things, we end up with trouble down the road. So we were very, very forward-looking in how we maintain these facilities. Your crews often after a rainstorm will be there 36 hours or more, right? I mean,
oh yeah, it's true. The first thing you need to do is make sure the system itself drains enough water out of it to where you can start dewatering your basin and actually back into the collection system down to Detroit. But then after it's dewatered, now you got to clean up the mess. So the GWK, for instance, has a flushing nozzle system where there's almost 300 different zones in there that just a deluge of water. They'll turn on zone one after another, and they'll flush all this
wash
debris.
Wash it down into the system.
Yeah, wash it back up into the sanitary system because a lot of that is sanitary debris. So it'll be pumped back into the interceptor system to go down to Detroit's treatment plant for treatment. So
the bulk of storms that hit us are either completely retained in this facility until the storm's over, and then it's sent down to Detroit for treatment. Or if it's not, it's whatever is more than it can hold is spilled into the Red Run drain, which goes into Lake St. Clair eventually. And the rest, whatever's left, is then also sent down there. And all the things that are cleaned up by the screens and all the things that settle, they're all sent down for treatment. So everything that we do, the water that we produce at the end of this facility is, you wouldn't mistake it for just pure clean water, right? I mean, it doesn't look polluted anymore. It looks very clean. We test it as it goes out so we know that the bacteria levels are way within the range that they're supposed to be.
Well, it's true, and all that is actually reported to the DEQ. So all four of those basins have what's called an NPDES permit through the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality. So that's a National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, is NPDES. So we're required by state law to report the actual water quality from every one of those discharge events. So all that information is posted, and it's all on the DEQ's website.
Yeah. Good. Well, I appreciate it. Okay, we're pretty much done. Is there anything you'd like to share that we haven't brought up directly?
I suppose it'd be a good point to make that a lot of times with sanitary sewage and collection systems, people there's a really out of sight, out of mind sort of mentality. That's, you know, right. you flush the toilet at home and it's gone. You don't think about where it goes or what happens to it after that. So a lot of people put You know, they might put waste down the toilet, things that don't need to be, you know, other than human waste. So it takes a great deal of effort to remove that debris back out of the water stream, out of the waste stream, but it all has to be taken back out. So I know we've really tried to change the mentality recently, in recent years, changing even the nomenclature from a wastewater treatment plant to a water resource recovery facility, because that's really what we're doing. We're trying to take all that. We use that water to remove our wastes from our communities, but then we want that water back. So we have to remove that waste back out again. So just something to think about, not to flush things down toilets or sinks just willy-nilly.
No, that's right. I say this all the time, that people think that it goes away, it must be good. What's to do about it? But we have like 350 employees that are out there making sure this stuff works every day. When it was 15 degrees below zero, my folks were out there working on water lines. So they, my folks are really dedicated people. Gary's one of those folks, and I really appreciate you coming in today and talking to us. I hope that helped. Going forward, I'm planning on bringing guests to talk about a whole range of issues around water. Water is our most important resource. You can live without food for 30 or 40 days. You can only live without water for a few days and you'll die. So if we don't have clean, fresh water and treat our sewage and our stormwater, we're in trouble. So my office is very concerned around that. I want to thank CMNtv for having this show and having us on. We're trying to do as much public education as we can, and this TV station is here for helping us, and I really appreciate that. So once again, I hope to be here again. We're trying to do this every 3 months. If you ever have any questions, please go to our Facebook page. If you have questions, comments, anything that we find interesting here, if you want to hear anything specific about something on a future show, let us know. We'd be happy to do that too. So thanks for coming, and hopefully we'll see you again. Thank you very much.